Welcome, and thank you for joining us. I pray that God would speak to you through His Word today. And as we start, let's join together and sing, Mighty to Save, and Lord, I come to You.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the change, renewed, flowing. swept away by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me, bring me near, draw me to your side.
Savior, the one who is mighty to save, we come to you this morning to worship you, to praise you, and to hear from you. You are the author of our salvation, and there is no one or anything that can give us what you can give us. Salvation from this world and its corruption caused by evil desires. And Father, we come to you. We come to you with hearts that are open and longing to hear from you. Change our hearts, Lord. Renew us as we seek your face. And thank you that through your Son's death, death and the grave have been conquered, and we can have a new life, forgiven from our sins. Receive our praise and our adoration this morning, and speak to our hearts. In the name of our glorious Saviour, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Have your Bibles with you. Turn to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1 to 4.
Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who through the righteousness of our God and Saviour, Jesus Christ, have received a faith as precious as ours. Grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Through these He has given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires.
I want you to cast your mind back. How many of you remember your school days? Pretty much most of us, I think, but who remembers their grade 9 or standard 7 maths? Now, I'm not talking about the teacher, just the subject. Honestly, I don't. Although there are times that I can't remember what I did yesterday, but that's not the point. See, people who can remember vast amounts of information, we consider to be extraordinary, you know, like those folk that have photographic memories. Now, this second letter of Peter is written just before Peter is martyred, and he's saying to his readers, I want you to remember some things that I've told you. And in this letter, he reminds us of some of the most important things he'd spoken and written about. And for some of us today, this will be like a revision, a reminder of what we've heard and what we know. But for others, this might be the first time that you actually hear it. See, God has given us a gift, and most of us miss the point of it. And we forget that we even have this gift, this great gift of salvation. So let's just set the background a bit to this letter. We know that Peter wrote this letter and he was an apostle of Jesus Christ. And we always find him listed as the first on the list of the apostles, you know, Peter, James, and John. He came to Jesus through his brother Andrew, who one day said to Peter, "We have found the Messiah," in John chapter 1. And he and his brother were fishermen, and they left everything and followed Jesus when Jesus said to them, "Follow me." How many of us would do that, or leave behind a successful business just to follow somebody? But up until he followed Jesus, he was known as Simon Bar-Jonah, or Simon son of John, as we read in the NIV translation. And then Jesus looks at him and says, "You will be called Cephas," or Peter, which in Aramaic and Greek both mean rock. Something Jesus saw in Peter. But Peter starts this second letter by saying, I want you to remember the great gift that God has given you in salvation. And I think that most of us have missed the point of salvation. We think, well, thank you, God, you've given us salvation. Now what's next? You know, we're a bit like that ungrateful kid who's given the top-of-the-range iPhone for their birthday. It has everything packed into it. But the kid looks at it and says, well, I wanted a calculator. The calculator, it has a calculator app in it. Yeah, but I wanted a notepad to write. But it's got an app for that. But I wanted a camera. But it's got one built in and you can edit and everything on this phone. But I wanted an MP3 player. But it's got that too. And so the list goes on. I want this. But it's all in that. And it's the same as us with God. God, I've got this salvation, but I want this and I want this and I want this. And God says to us, these things that you want and think that you don't have and desire, they're all included in your salvation. And what does Peter say? Well, the first thing he says to us is, remember where your salvation comes from. So Peter starts by introducing the letter. He says, Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ. What do you call yourself? What's your identity? For Peter, it was servant of God. And when that identity of servant of God becomes our identity, we're freed from so many things. The greatest leaders and Christians in the Bible took this title of servant of God as their own. And you look at how they announced themselves. Think of Moses. He said, Moses, a servant of God. And Joshua, a servant of God. David, not a king or a mighty warrior, but David, a servant of God. And all the prophets as well. James, even James, the brother of Jesus, didn't say, well, I'm James, the brother of Jesus. He said, I'm James, the servant of God. And there are many others that called themselves servant of God. But what is a servant? Well, it's a person who is owned by a master, who is at the master's disposal. His rights are surrendered to the master. He's got unquestionable loyalty to the master. So when you say you're a servant of God, you're saying that you are owned by God, that you are at God's disposal, and that all your rights are surrendered to God, and that you have unquestionable loyalty to God. And then Peter says that through righteousness you have received a faith. So how did we receive this faith, this salvation? Well, it didn't come from any of our worthiness, because we don't have any. Oh, it's not from any good that we have done. As Ephesians 2 verse 8 and 9 says, for it is by grace that you have been saved, through faith, and this not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. You know, it's a bit like a person choking. It's only through the intervention of someone else that you're able to breathe again. You know, that person coming along and giving you the Heimlich maneuver and unblocking your airway. It's the same way in Ephesians 2 verse 1, where Paul tells us that we were dead in our sins, but God, who is rich in mercy, has made us alive. One day in the past we heard the gospel, the good news, and our eyes and our hearts were opened, and God gave us the faith to believe in Him. He intervened and He gave us life. That's how we obtain salvation. And Peter says in verse 1 that we have received a faith as precious, other translations say as equal standing, as His. In other words, the faith that we have received is equal to the faith that He received. It's the same righteousness that Peter, James, and John, that those top disciples had. Our righteousness, our faith, our salvation is equal in standing to theirs. Yes, we may have a greater knowledge now than them because we have the New Testament, which they didn't have, but we have the same privileges as Peter. And our access to God is the same as theirs was. Secondly, we need to remember what salvation is. And verse 2 tells us, salvation is abundant streams of mercy flowing to us every single day. It's streams of grace, that free, undeserving favor to sinners who believe the gospel. It's a peace, the effect that forgiveness has on your life. It's a peace with God and a peace from God. It's a peace for every trial that you'll encounter. Peace from Jesus, as He says in John 14, 27, my peace I give to you. And salvation is truth, as Jesus says in John 8, verse 31 and 32. If you hold my teaching, you are really my disciples, and then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. But it's not merely knowing the truth. It's knowing Him who is the truth, through His word, and growing in it every single day. And salvation, it's also a faith, which at this time, I think it's being stretched. You know, we wonder, how can I have faith in a time like this? But where do we get our faith from? Romans chapter 10 verse 17 tells us that faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. And thirdly, remember that salvation is enough, as verse 3 and 4 tells us. A lot of us think that our salvation was enough to forgive us our sins, but it wasn't enough to sanctify us or to free us from the power of sins, or that it was enough to get us through the trials and the problems of life, or maybe even to keep us saved. But salvation is enough for all of these. Matthew, in his account of the Gospel in chapter 22, records Jesus' words where he compares salvation to a lavish wedding feast. The king who holds the feast is God. The son for whom the feast is held is Jesus. And the servants are the Old Testament prophets. None of the invited guests come, so the king opens the wedding feast to everyone. And we are that everyone who can now feast at the banquet, a salvation that is full and free and plentiful. But in verses 3 and 4, Peter highlights four parts of salvation. The first is power. And this is God's divine power that he's granted to us. On your own, you aren't enough or sufficient, but with God's power, you have enough and you are sufficient. It isn't enough to have only your own power, which is really nothing. Your power alone is insufficient, but God's power is enough. Paul says in Ephesians 3:20 that it's Jesus' power that is at work within us, that power that can do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine. And this is the power of the Holy Spirit, that same power that raised Jesus from the dead, that same power is at work within you. But there's a downside to this power. Sin diminishes its power. So that's why we have to regularly confess the sin in our lives, coming to God and saying, forgive me for what I've done. See, self-sufficiency, this I can do this, is one of those sins, because we're not sufficient apart from God. We have to daily rely on him and his word through prayer and through reading of his word. The second one is victory. Peter says that everything we need for life and godliness. Because we regularly fail and sin, we feel that we're missing something, or there's something we desperately need to be godly. But we don't need mystical experiences or private revelations, because he has already given us everything that we need. Paul in 1 Corinthians 10 verse 13 talks about temptation. He says that no temptation has seized you that is common to man. Common as in that everyone is tempted. But as a believer, I don't want to do it, because there will never be a temptation that I won't be able to say no to. And God will always provide a way of escape when we are tempted. And why? Because we have everything we need for life and godliness. The third is revelation. In giving us salvation, God reveals himself to us through his Holy Spirit. We have knowledge of God. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 2 verse 12 that through salvation we've been given the Spirit of God, that we might understand what God has freely given to us. And he goes on to say in verse 14 that a person without the Spirit, that someone who doesn't have salvation, does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God. So through salvation, God reveals not only himself to us, but also all that we have and are in him. And the fourth point of salvation, as Peter writes, is promises. And Peter writes in verse 4, he has given us his very great and precious promises. And through these promises, we may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption of the world caused by evil desires. Did you know that God has never given you a promise that you never needed? Did you realize that? And that at some point in your life, you will need those promises. And just what are some of these promises? Well, it's the promise of his presence, found in Hebrews 13 verse 5, where he says, I will never leave you or forsake you. It's the promise of his protection, as found in Genesis 15 verse 1, where he says, I am your shield. It's the promise of power in your life, Isaiah 41, or the promise of his leading in John chapter 10. It's the promise of his purposes in Jeremiah 29, where he says, for I know the plans that I have for you. It's the promise of his rest in Matthew 11, where he says, come to me all who are weak, and I will give you rest. It's the promose of his cleansing in 1 John 1 verse 9, where he says, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's the promise of goodness in Psalm 84. And it's the promise of a wise plan for your life in Romans 8 verse 28, where Paul writes that in all things God works for the good of those who love him. These promises and many others are so that we can be a partaker in the divine nature and become like him. when the Wright brothers, who were actually bicycle salesmen, finally succeeded in flying the first aeroplane for 59 seconds on December the 17th, 1903, they rushed a telegram to their sister in Dayton, Ohio, telling her of the amazing accomplishment. And the telegram read like this: "First sustained flight today, 59 seconds. Hope to be home by Christmas." Their sister was so excited that she rushed to the newspaper office and communicated the telegram to the editor. The next morning, the newspaper headline carried a small article headlined, "Popular local bicycle merchants to be home for the holidays." The scoop of the century was missed because someone wasn't clear. The editor had missed the point. Have we maybe missed the point of our salvation? We think of it as a door to heaven or as an exit from earth, but in the time in between there's nothing really for us. Well, salvation is for right now. It's for you now to receive all these blessings that God has offered to you. And they're included in the offer of salvation. You know the TV adverts, but that's not all. We'll also include at no extra cost. Well, it's the same. We just need to access them when we understand what our salvation is all about. Not just a ticket, but a life of power, a life of victory, a life of revelation, and a life of promise now. So remember where your salvation came from and your new identity. Remember what your salvation is, abundant streams of grace and mercy, and remember that your salvation is enough. Maybe you're wondering, but I don't get any of that. My life isn't like that. Well, then maybe you need to ask yourself and have a look at yourself and ask, do you really have salvation? If you're unsure of your salvation, but you want to exercise your faith, then I invite you to pray a short prayer with me. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you that you died on the cross for my sins. Right now, to the best of my ability, I turn from my old life to you, and I ask that you make me your child. I want to experience the power, the victory, the revelation, and the promise that I read about in your word. I ask that you would forgive me my sins and that you'd give me a new home in heaven. Thank you for your forgiveness and giving me salvation. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, know that you are a child of God and that you have salvation that is real and now. Father, I thank you for giving us faith that we can rely on you and come to you and receive your forgiveness. Let us know today without a doubt that you are our Savior and that our salvation is only in you. You say in your word that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, and that is us today. We call upon your name, and we thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's join together as we sing "Before the Throne of God Above." Gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that you sit on the throne and that Jesus is our great high priest. And thank you, Jesus, for pleading on our behalf before the Father's throne. And for Father, thank you for the salvation that you give to us, a salvation that is rich and free, a salvation that comes from you. And thank you, too, that there's nothing that I need to do to add to the work done for our salvation, because your salvation is enough. And thank you that through your salvation we receive your power, your victory, your revelation, and your promises. We pray that we would never question or doubt this most precious gift that you've given to us. And Lord, for us who have heard your word today, for those whom it was just a revision of things that they knew, Lord, give them a fresh heart to love you more. Empower them through your Holy Spirit to carry on in their walk with Jesus. And for those who this may have been a first time that they hear the message of salvation, pray that through the prompting of your Holy Spirit that they would have opened their hearts to Jesus as their Savior, that in faith that they would have received him as not only their Savior, but their Redeemer and their friend. And Holy Spirit, fill them with love and a longing to grow in the knowledge and the wisdom of God, to love his word and to walk closely with him. And to our God who sits on the throne, to Jesus our risen Lamb, and to the Holy Spirit our comforter and guide, we give you all the glory, honour and praise. And in the name of the one who is our perfect righteousness, Jesus Christ our Saviour, we pray this all. Amen. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit keep our hearts and souls in his love and care, now and forevermore. Amen. Let's join together and sing now unto him.
Now unto him. Glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever.
May you have a wonderful and a blessed day today. God bless you all. Amen.
with guilt and sin. He is there to lift me, heal me and forgive me, gives me strength to stand again, stronger than I was before. So with forever, love's unfading splendor, earth.